And now, in tribute to Barry Humphries, who sadly passed away, another chance to hear his series of Barry's forgotten musical masterpieces, first broadcast in 2020, as he recalls his favourite period of recorded music, transporting you back to the first half of the 20th century. It's a culturally thrilling series of vintage music, which provides entertaining and thought-provoking musical snapshots from the past. And Barry's enthusiasm for this music is so infectious.
Hello, I'm Barry Humphries, and I'd like to welcome you to this, the first programme in my new four-part series of Forgotten Musical Masterpieces for BBC Radio 2. Yes, listeners, I'm back by popular demand and against medical advice. In this particular programme, I'm taking you back to the flamboyant, rebellious, decadent, irresponsible, progressive and totally promiscuous 1920s. They didn't call them roaring for nothing.
Futuristic rhythm, never on the beat. In an eardrum, in my eardrum, blows me off my seat. You're the unexpected, disconnected time. Let me drink in, sleep and think in futuristic rhyme. Must you blow that ba-da-da-da, ba-da-da-da all night through? When you know that ba-da-da-da, ba-da-da-da makes me goofy. Futuristic rhythm, dance until I drop. Never tire, I'm afire, don't you ever stop.
My thanks to Irving Mills and his band for providing such a lively musical introduction to my new series of forgotten music. That disc, entitled Futuristic Rhythm, has more than stood the test of time, rather like me. I trust you agree. It's particularly apposite because in this episode I've set my turntable time machine to the Jazz Age. So named because of the success of F. Scott Fitzgerald's collection of stories, Tales of the Jazz Age, published in 1922. It was also the era of the Bright Young Things, whose flamboyant behaviour inspired the cult of celebrity in Britain before Andy Warhol was born on the other side of the Atlantic. Baby Andy Warhola, to give him his original surname, didn't arrive in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, until August 1928, when the big long party of the 1920s was in its final throes. By then, the likes of Olivia Plunket Greene and her brothers Richard and David, Elizabeth Ponsonby, Stephen Tennant, Harold Acton, and Brenda Dean Paul had been chased almost constantly by the paparazzi, who sought to capture the Bright Young Things' outrageous behaviour on film. Tales of this privileged group's exploits made the front page headlines almost daily.
Age calls the tune, youth sober soon, that is the natural law. There's a younger generation, knock, knock, knocking at the door. Why sit and fret, vainly regret, things that have gone before? There's a younger generation, knock, knock, knocking at the door. Though the world is well lost for love dream, there's wisdom above dreams to compensate mothers and wives. When the joys of youth have passed them, this should last them all their lives. I've had my fun, all that is done, why should I sigh for more? There's a younger generation knock, knock, knocking at the door. Generation knock, knock, knocking at the door.
Voice of Al Bowley with Noel Coward's Little Heard Song, The Younger Generation.
In a British barrack square, the night before the war, came the news that every four next day were ordered to the fore. Scotchmen sang with pride. Men of Harling marched to glory. Gallant Welshmen cried. God save Ireland, sang a hero with a real old Irish swing. Then every mother's son proudly held a gun and sang, God save our king. Regimental band. Music, music thrills the soul at home in love and war. When we roam from home, sweet home, visions it brings once more. Should old acquaintance be forgot, the Scotchman sang with pride. Gallant Welshmen cried. God save Ireland, sang a hero with a real old Irish swing. Then every mother's son proudly held a gun and sang, God save our king.
In that song, they sang God Save the King, recorded in 1914, the Australian musical entertainer Florrie Ford celebrated the commitment of soldiers from each of the nations in Great Britain and Ireland. The members of the Bright Young Things were mostly the younger sons and daughters of the aristocracy. They also included a few members of the middle classes who were seeking to advance their careers through association with toffs. They belonged to a generation that was too young to fight in the Great War. The slaughter of so many of their friends and family had taught them to seize the day.
Mm-hmm.
the unmistakable sound and rhythm of the Charleston, performed by the Savoy Hotel Orpheans, one of the era's premier London dance bands, founded in 1923 by De Broglie Summers. The great Harlem stride pianist James P. Johnson originally composed the Charleston for the Broadway show Runnin' Wild in 1923, and the energetic dance craze then quickly swept through America and Europe. A new age, the jazz age, had dawned. It was a time when the strict rules, not only of music, but of society too, were cast aside, as were ladies' corsets. Of course, some stiff upper lips remained very firmly stiff, but the great majority began to breathe a huge sigh of relief. The world had definitely changed.
It was down in Tennessee that the jazzy melody originated, then waited for popularity. Now in every cabaret, it's the only thing they play. I love to hear it, must be near it, that's why I say, take me to the land of jazz. Let me hear the kind of blues that Memphis has. I want to step to a tune that's full of ginger and pep. Just pick them up and lay them down. Learn to do the razzmatazz. And let me give you a warning, we won't get home until morning, cause everybody's full of jazz, oh, in the lovely land of jazz. Everybody's full of jazz, oh, in the loving land of jazz. There is music in each breeze, even trombones grow on trees. You hear a moaning and groaning, that tuneful harmonies. Every cotton planter sobs when he meets his loving heart. Is simply pestered and requested to join the fun. So take me to the land of jazz. Let me hear the kind of blues that Memphis has. I want to step to a tune that's full of ginger and pep. Just pick 'em up and lay 'em down. Learn to do the razzmatazz. Now let me give you a warning, we won't get home until morning.
Billy Murray with the miraculous Take Me to the Land of Jazz, recorded by him as far back as 1919, the year after the war. When I see the name Billy Murray on a record, I know I'm in safe hands. His are amongst some of the earliest recordings that I play on my little programs here on the wireless, because they are still exceptionally fine. That can't be said of all the discs I discover on my expeditions, trawling for things to play to you. So you can rest assured that I only bring you the best.
Thank you.
Duke Ellington and his band with the atmospheric Harlem twist. The fame of the Bright Young Things started when a group of well-bred, well-heeled, modern young gels decided to organise a number of treasure hunts around London on public transport, making a complete spectacle of themselves in the process. Zita Jungman and her sister Theresa, just for a laugh, famously tried to spend the night at Madame Tussaud's Chamber of Horrors, but were discovered by security staff during the night. Elizabeth Ponsonby was the original It Girl. Her father was, at one point, Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs, and he felt his daughter was made for better things. Her extravagant pranks embarrassed him, but worse was to come. Elizabeth partied hard and drank herself to death before she was 40. I think this next track, recorded by Tom Clare in 1924, could well have been the signature tune of many of the Bright Young Things.
When one meets with a friend, one can always depend. How one starts the meeting will not affect to the end. Friend says, how do you do? You say, fine, old son. Then passers-by hear the old college cry, well, let's go and have just one. And when one's had one, one wants one little one more. One has one, one has two, then one wants the score. What did Gladstone say in 84? When one's had one little one, one wants one little one more.
Tom Clare with his wonderful song about addiction, One Little One More, written in 1924. Between the Sheets was the title of a favoured drink of the Bright Young Things. It was a version of the classic sidecar cocktail, made up of a mixture of rum, cognac and triple sec, sharpened with a touch of lemon. Reprobates known collectively as the Bright Young Things included many writers. Siegfried Sassoon, John Betjeman, Nancy Mitford, Cecil Beaton left us his diaries from the period along with his many wonderful photographs. And Evelyn Waugh left us his novels, which are packed full with characters and plots based on the lives of the members of this bohemian group. Beverly Nichols rather arrogantly wrote about his exploits as a Bright Young Thing in his autobiography, published in 1926, when he was only 25. In fact, 25 is the title of his book. I like to think that's what gave Adele the idea for the title of her albums. Though I suspect that Adele, much as I admire her, was not an avid reader of the works of Beverly Nichols, whose last piece of published writing was, I'm happy to say, an introduction to one of Dame Edna's fascinating books.
I wanna go places and do things, see new faces and new things, go places and do things with you. I wanna be stepping in fast time, that's my favorite pastime. I'm aching to start shaking a shoe. I know that petting is getting to be a popular indoor sport, but listen dearie, I'm weary of decorating a Davenport. I gotta go places and do things, see new faces and new things, go places and do things with you. I stammer, I stutter, but hardly can utter a word. I'm effervescing, but still I'm suppressing a feeling to fly like a bird. I'm all a twitter, I'm all a twirl, I'm all a twitter about a girl. Yes, and she seems to be all a twitter for me. ¶¶
Jack Hilton with I Want to Go Places and Do Things, and he did. Starting in 1920, Jack Hilton's fame as the most famous bandleader in Britain lasted for 2 decades. The brightest star of the bright young things was Stephen Tennant. He's said to have been the inspiration of the character of Cedric in Nancy Mitford's novel Love in a Cold Climate. When he wasn't being pursued by the paparazzi, the youngest son of the Earl of Glenconner spent most of his time in bed. Unlike many of his contemporaries, though, he lived to grow old. He died at the age of 81 in 1987 in bed.
Just like yesterday, I got up today with so much to be done. All I could do was think of you. Now it's striking 10, time for bed again, and another day's gone. All I could do was write to you. Just another day wasted away, watching and waiting. Just another day wasted away, filled with gloom. All day all alone, hoping you would phone, but you never called me. Covered miles of ground, pacing up and down, round my room. Just another night, nothing inside, nothing but grieving. When I go to sleep, memories will creep, making me blue. And when the break of dawn I see, what's it gonna mean to me? Just another day, wasted away, thinking of you. Every night and day, every different way, how I've tried to forget. All I could do was think of you. Blue as I can be, nothing left for me, nothing dear but regret. All I can do is wait for you. Just another day wasted away, watching and waiting. Just another day wasted away, filled with gloom. All day all alone, hoping you would phone, but you never called me. Covered miles of ground, pacing up and down, round my room. Just another night, nothing inside, nothing but grieving. When I go to sleep, memories will creep, making me blue. And when the break of dawn I see, what's it gonna mean to me? Just another day, wasted away, thinking of you.
Annette Hanshaw, accompanied by Willard Robinson on the piano, and the song was Just Another Day Wasted Away, recorded in October 1927. Annette was the archetypal flapper. And for jazz enthusiasts, her recordings are of particular interest due to the wealth of top-name musicians involved. Names like Red Nichols, Miff Mole, Joe Venuti, Eddie Lang, Benny Goodman, Jack Teagarden, and the Dorsey Brothers.
Who stole my heart away? Who makes me dream all day? Dreams I know can never come true. Seems as though I'll ever be blue. Would I answer yes to? Well, you ought to but you.
George Olsen and his band with the song simply entitled Who. At that time, the best-known nightclub owner in London was Mrs. Kate Merrick. She opened Dalton's in Leicester Square in 1919 in partnership with Harry Dalton, and she followed it up with a succession of clubs, the most famous being the 43 Club in Soho. Mrs. Merrick catered for both the nobility and the underworld elite, and suffered for it with 5 prison sentences for selling liquor after hours. And in 1929, she was sentenced to 15 months for bribing a Metropolitan Police sergeant. Mrs. Merrick caught flu in early 1933 and never recovered. On the day of her funeral, West End theatres and clubs dimmed their lights to pay their respects because she was held in such high esteem. Irving Mills and his band performing for the second time in this programme. In that track, you heard the band doin' the new lowdown. Well, whatever that was, I'm sure it was scandalous. Irving Mills, of course, was a famous band leader, but he was also a manager, largely responsible for the early success of his client Duke Ellington. Oddly enough, his grandson was my PA for a number of years and is still a close friend, and he gave me a photograph of his grandfather, Irving Mills, leaning on a piano which was being played by Ellington, and a bystander was Percy Grainger in the photograph, the famous Australian composer. If you've just tuned in, this is the critically acclaimed, popular and useful vintage music show, Forgotten Musical Masterpieces, presented by me, Barry Humphries. in this show, I'm commemorating the dawn of the jazz age and the decadent, fascinating lifestyle of the bright young things. Brenda Dean Paul reportedly lived on brandy cocktails and salted peanuts. That was for years until she found something much harder to consume. Known by the press as the society drug addict, she was in and out of what we now call rehab and prison too. Another key member of the group was Bryan Guinness, whom I knew very, very well. He was the heir to the Guinness brewing fortune. He was a handsome, charming man who was not quite charming enough for his first wife, Diana Mitford. She caused quite a stir when she left Bryan for Oswald Moseley. Bryan told me in his old age that he'd been to a party sometime in the late 1920s and been introduced to Diana Moseley. And he said to her, "I think we've met somewhere before." And she said, "Oh, yes, we have. We were married." In 1929, Bryan Guinness was one of the main organisers of the Bruno Hat Hoax, an art exhibition held at his home. It involved staging a convincing public exhibition of paintings by an imaginary, reclusive artist called Bruno Hat. Along with my old friend John Betjeman, Bryan Guinness was also a member of the infamous Railway Club, a group of Oxford students who regularly dined in black tie on an express train between Oxford and Leicester. One of my favourite bright young things is Elsa Lanchester. She set up the Cave of Harmony nightclub in London, frequented by Evelyn Waugh, in which plays and cabaret turns were performed. Elsa recorded a fabulous song, which, for me, sums up the mood of the era better than any other record. The title, "Don't Tell My Mother I'm Living in Sin."
Beside an empty barrel, upon a foreign shore, there sat the wreck of a human man, a human man no more. An opium pipe is in his hand, he has not shaved for days. The pack of cards that strew the sand, the horrid truth displays. When why, says I, that ain't Ned, he raised his bloodshot eyes and said, "Don't tell my mother I'm living in sin, don't let the old folks know, don't tell my twin that I breakfast on gin, he'd never survive the blow. Promise you'll keep little Maggie from harm, you'll have to take care with a girl of her charm. Don't let her know about whiskey and snow, don't let her go to them clubs in Soho, but tell all the world of the ruin you see. This is what comes of the night at the Metropole. See what it's done for me." The broken reed continues. I never swore a swore. I never kissed a woman's hand till I was 24. They took me to a night. Then I was a lad to know, and all the rips of Wimbledon was dancing in a row. A so-called aunt of pleasure, see, and it was that what done for me. Don't tell my mother survive the blow. Promise you'll cherish my dear little niece, warn her of kissing before the police. See that her youth isn't wrecked by vermouth. Pull her up short if she goes for the port. Keep her from nightclubs and tell her from me. This is what comes of a night in Bohemia. See what it's done for me.
Wasn't that simply wonderful? The remarkable Elsa Lanchester. She was uniquely talented, way ahead of her time, and when one looks back at her early work now, one can't help feeling that she would have been far better off if she decided not to get married to Charles Laughton. Her unique talent was steadily crushed by the weight of domesticity and possibly also by the weight of Charles Laughton. Elsa Lanchester's marriage to Charles Laughton, the portly actor, or to anyone else for that matter, broke the family mould. Her parents had been front-page news long before Elsa was born because they insisted in 1895 on living together and not getting married at all. Elsa's mother, Edith, was incarcerated by her own family in a lunatic asylum. They were so appalled at the prospect of their daughter and sister living in sin. So Elsa's famous party turn, which we've just heard, has an autobiographical quality. Of course, this created a national scandal and was front-page news. Eventually, Edith was declared sane. Upon her release, she said she intended to set up home with her lover and not get married, and never saw her father, the instigator of her torture, again. Here's a dusty delight from 1926. The title, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes.
That makes a kind old gentleman respond. Since the world began, every gentleman is just a man who's gentle to a blonde. The most neglected girls in town are those with hair of black or brown, 'cause gentlemen prefer blonde. The red-haired and the sweet brunette make very lovely household pets, but gentlemen prefer blonde. A curly head of yellow without any sense can always make a fellow pay all the expense. A girly with a golden crop can take a Scotsman out to shop, 'cause gentlemen prefer blonde. A married redhead or brunette will soon discover with regret that gentlemen prefer blonde. The hair she finds on her vestibule when he comes home makes her believe that gentlemen prefer blonde. A girl with golden tresses who's touched up her hair is wearing all the dresses the wife ought to wear. For upside on the lady's dome will help to keep her husband home, 'cause gentlemen prefer blonde.
Joyce Barber with Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. The number was inspired by Anita Loos's masterpiece, in my view. It was a major literary hit in the 1920s, and it formed the basis for the later, now infamous, 1950s musical comedy starring Marilyn Monroe and Jane Russell. The 1920s brought many new things and attitudes, including the first birth control clinic in London in March 1921. It followed the publication of a book on the subject entitled Married Love, written by Maurice Stopes. It was first published by a small publisher in 1918 after many larger publishers had turned it down due to its controversial content. But when it finally hit the bookshops, it sold out rapidly and was in its sixth printing within a fortnight. It was the 50 Shades of Grey of its day.
All this world is up to date. Even children stay up late. Things are not just what they used to be. All this world is off its nut. Going crazy, nothing but. Just get this earful from me. Since making whoopee became all the rage, it's even got to the old birdcage. My canary has circles under his eyes. He used to whistle the prisoner's song. Now he does snake hips the whole night long. My canary has circles under his eyes. Now there was a time he was satisfied to flit among the flowers. But now when I let him out, he'll hide up in a tree for hours. Instead of taking a much-needed rest, he's flying out to some sparrow's nest. My canary has circles under his eyes. He has no girlfriends that I'm certain of, but he thinks, what is this thing called love? My canary has circles under his eyes. Of a feather, the old story goes, but love is something nobody knows. My poor canary has circles under his eyes. Oh, maybe he's worried the little lamb. He always looks so solemn. I wonder if he is in a jam. I looked in Swapper's column. He won't eat his bird seed, it's really a sin. He won't sing a thing without his drop of gin. My canary has circles under his eyes.
Wasn't that simply charming? The sweet voice of Elsie Carlyle with My Canary Has Circles Under His Eyes. She recorded that song after the long party of the 20s had worn out even the wildlife. Neil Tennant of the Pet Shop Boys says, before the Beatles, there was Noel Coward. I couldn't agree with him more. Noel put his experiences and his observations on his times into the plots of his plays and the lyrics of his songs, such as World Weary, 20th Century Blues, Cosmopolitan Lady, Poor Little Rich Girl, and The Party's Over Now, to name just a few of the master's musical masterpieces. Also notably, in a sketch called The Swiss Family Whittlebot, in the review London Calling, Coward satirised mercilessly the Sitwell family. They never forgave him. Here is the master, Noel Coward, in a jaded mood with one of his own songs.
When I'm feeling weary and blue, I'm only too glad to be left alone. Dreaming of a place in the sun when day is done, far from a telephone. Hardly ever see the sky, buildings seem to grow so high. Give me somewhere peaceful and grand where all the land slumbers in monotone. I'm world weary, living in a great big town. I find it so dreary, so dreary. Everything looks gray all round. I want an ocean blue, great big trees, a bird's eye view of the Pyrenees. I want to watch the moon rise up and see the great red sun go down. Watching clouds go by through a windy sky fascinates me. But if I do it in the street, every cop I meet simply hates me. Because I'm world weary, world weary, tired of all these jumping jacks. I want to get right back to nature and relax. I'm world weary, world weary, living in a great big town. I find it so dreary, so dreary. Everything looks gray all round. I want a horse and plow, chickens too, just one cow with a wistful moo. A country where the verb to work becomes a most improper noun. I can hardly wait till I see the great open spaces. My loving friends will not be there. I'm so sick of their damn fool faces. Because I'm world weary, world weary. I could kiss the railroad tracks. I wanna get right back to nature, assume a horizontal stature. I wanna get right back to nature and relax.
Noel Coward with World Weary, which was first introduced in the London Review show This Year of Grace in 1928. It was produced by the great C.B. Cochran, known as Cocky for short. And he was.
The party's over now, the dawn is drawing very nigh, the candles gather, the starlight leaves the sky. It's time for little girls and boys to hurry home to bed, for there's a new day waiting just ahead. Life is sweet, but time is fleet beneath the magic of the moon. Dancing time may seem sublime, but it is ended all too soon. The thrill has gone to linger on, would spoil it anyhow. Let's creep away from the day, for the party's over now.
The Bright Young Things were the original party animals. 1929 started a period of economic decline and mass unemployment in Britain and across the world. Set against that backdrop of the Great Depression, the decadent and irresponsible lifestyle and the wild behaviour of the Bright Young Things was becoming increasingly distasteful. Rather than entertaining, the group's antics became irritating. The red and white ball of November 1931 was labelled the Party Too Far. Denounced by the press, the ball signalled the end of the era of the Bright Young Things.
The party's over now, the dawn is drawing very nigh, the candles gather, the starlight leaves the sky. It's time for little girls and boys to hurry home to bed, for there's a new day waiting just ahead. Life is sweet, but time is fleet beneath the magic of the moon. Dancing time may seem sublime, but it is ended all too soon. The thrill has gone, to linger on would spoil it anyhow. Let's creep away from the day, for the party's over now.
Well, sadly, we're almost at the end of this edition of Forgotten Musical Masterpieces. But I'll be back on the wireless again soon with more dusty delights to entertain you. As Isham Jones and his band play us out, there's just time to tell you that this was a Strauss House production for BBC Radio 2. My producer is Claire Wordsworth. Claire, thank you. And until next time, it's goodbye from me, Barry Humphries. Thanks for having me at your place.